Hi there, and welcome to another episode of Outdoor 101. Today we're going to tackle our packing issues. What to pack and how much? There's lots of equipment you can consider bringing for a hike, but before we touch that subject, we're going to look at two other questions. How much can I carry, and how far can I walk in a day? That's two questions we need to combine when we are planning our hike, and to my knowledge, there is no simple answer to this. Most healthy adults can lift somewhere close to their body weight, but if you try to move that weight around, it won't be easy even for shorter distances, and you will be hard-pressed to keep it off the ground for an extended amount of time. In the same way, you can probably walk the length of a marathon if you're totally unburdened, and you will still have plenty of time to take breaks for food and such without any larger degrees of discomfort. But if you start to add weight to your load, both the distance and your level of comfort will gradually decrease. And while I'm Captain Obvious, I will also state that the way you carry your load and the terrain you're walking through will have a large impact on the outcome. And then, of course, it's your general fitness and the weather and so forth. By now it's clear we can't just bring up a spreadsheet and insert some data and find out how much weight you can carry a certain distance in a certain time. We'll have to find this out with a practical experiment. First of all, you have to decide a route that takes approximately an hour to walk at a comfortable pace. If you have a trail nearby with some slopes, that's perfect, but if you haven't, just walk in the neighborhood. Then we need some way to measure your walk. Most smartphones today have some kind of step counting app that can measure distance and time and your pace. And if your smartphone doesn't have one built in, there's a cartload of free ones you can find online. For day one, walk your route without any burdens. Walk in a comfortable pace, but still covers a lot of ground. You register your time, your pace, and the distance. And last but not least, you grade your comfort on a scale from 1 to 10, where 10 is extremely comfortable. For day 2, you pick up a backpack and you fill it so it weighs approximately 10% of your body weight. And now you walk your route again. Register time, distance, pace, and grade your comfort on the same scale once more. And an optional day 3. If you still have room in your backpack, fill it up so it weighs approximately 20% of your body weight, and you repeat your route again. Register time, distance, and pace, and your comfort. When you made your walks, it's time to compare the results. Did anything change? And in that case, what? By now you should have a rough understanding on how you react to increased loads, both physically, but also the choices you made. Did you sacrifice your comfort to keep up the speed, or the other way around? I won't say there's a right or wrong here, but the important part is for you to have an understanding so you can plan your hike according to your own conditions. With that said, if your first hike leaves you with a high level of discomfort, there will probably not be a second one. So keep it somewhat light and simple. And this is even more important if you try to introduce someone else to hiking. So, now it's time to fill our backpacks. So, what do I need for a hike? Well, the correct answer is kind of useless. It depends. It depends on what kind of a hike you're planning. Is it a day hike, an overnighter, multi-day hike? Do you need food or water? What are the weather conditions? For a short hike in the summer, like 3 to 6 kilometers, you probably don't need anything at all, except a bottle of water and a camera or a phone to take some pictures. You will be completely unburdened, and the only breaks you take is to admire the views and take some pictures. I would, however, argue that you should always carry some kind of first aid on your person. Some painkillers, band-aids and blister patches. You can make such a first aid pack much smaller than your phone, so it would fit easily in your pocket. An important tool when you're packing is your packing list. You can make a generic one with the things you always pack in, no matter what kind of hike you're planning. For example, band-aids and hydration. Then you adapt the list to fit the hike. Are you sleeping out? Are you cooking? Etc. Tick off every item on your list when you're packing so you really get it all. No matter if you've done 100 hikes, you can still forget your spoon or toothbrush, and not to mention the toilet paper. After the hike, when you unpack, make a note of every item you didn't use, and if it wasn't the safety gear, you can question if that's something that you should bring on your next hike. Same for the things that you didn't bring and you really missed. Did you miss them enough to bring them next time? It's likely that this list will change over time, and you will make separate lists for different hiking styles, since your needs will vary. There's some different way you can carry your pack. If you're going for a short day hike, a haversack or something similar will work just fine, but as soon as you start to exceed 10 to 15 liters pack size, I think a backpack is the only viable option, really. If you're just starting out and don't have a backpack of your own, try to rent one or borrow one in the beginning. And if you have an old one, use it. Learn all the adjustments you can do with it. In the end of the day, there's a large difference between kind of okay adjustments and nailing them. And give yourself plenty of time to find out what kind of features that are important in a backpack to you. For me, it's very important to have airflow between the pack and myself. When I hike, I generate heat, a lot of heat. And if the backpack is flush to me, I will be soaked in a matter of minutes. So, let's plan for the day hike. If you're out for the better part of a day in an environment where you can't or won't rely on services for foods and drinks, then you have to bring it with you. And here your options are more or less limitless. Anything from fruit to sandwiches up to the ingredients for a large meal that you cook on site. Some change of clothes if the weather changes. And why not some swimwear if you're hiking close to a lake in the summertime? For a day hike, a backpack, 10 to 20 liters probably should be plenty if you're not planning on bringing a barbecue and your favorite recliner. Now for the overnighter, and here's where we start to level up the amount of gear we bring, since you're going to need a sleeping system. I see bushcrafters that go out with only a wool blanket, but I would recommend you that a sleeping bag and a sleeping pad is the bare minimum. And then it's where you know that there is a shelter on site, or you're planning to sleep under the stars. It's a fantastic experience, but where I live, I'm happy if I can do it once or twice a year. So I would bring some kind of shelter too, a tent or a tarpaulin. And then you want some food and drinks, so you're probably gonna need a cooking system. And then you will need extra clothes if the weather changes, for example. And now we have need of a backpack that's approximately 35 to 40 liters. And some of the gear will probably be strapped on the outside of your pack if it isn't super small. And when we're packing for a multi-day hike, the only thing we really need to add is extra food and extra clothes. And depending on how many days you're planning to be out, you might have to level up even further in pack size. And if you're solo hiking, you have to carry everything yourself. But if you're a pair or group, then you can split the load. For example, one person carries the cooking system and the other one carries the food. And when it comes to filling your backpack, there's loads of ways to do it right. But you can say there's two rule of thumbs you should follow. And the first one is you should put the heavy stuff close to your body and rather high up, somewhere in the neighborhood of your shoulder blades. In that way you don't shift your own center of gravity too much. If you shift that too much, it will be difficult to keep your balance when you're going on a trail, especially if it's rough terrain. And the other rule of thumb, things you will need in a hurry should be easy accessible. So, if, for example, in my LK35, that's basically a big bucket, rain gear goes on top. In my large Osprey, I have several compartments, 6 or 7 pockets something, and more than one way into the main compartment. So there I have much more leeway on where I put things that I need in a hurry. And my personal third rule when packing is everything goes inside the pack. I dislike having things strapped on the outside. It's basically the sleeping pad that's okay to have on the outside. Everything else has a place on the inside. It makes the pack more silent, and I know it's protected and it's harder to drop things. I hope that you got a good overview on the packing by now and some hints on how to plan your hike. As usual in this series, I won't say that specific gear is the best one, because the gear that is best for you is what you have and know how to use. The challenge is for you when you pack is to get enough gear that so you don't miss anything when you're out on your hike, and at the same time, don't wish that you had left half of it at home when you're carrying it around. And that knowledge can only come from practice. So, get up and get out, and I hope to catch you outdoors. Cheers till the next time.